speedboat in your rack. He a free throw, man down, call out Amber Lambs. Tell him free bro, Melanie, to the cross, he walk around like Tito. What's up with these Jordanier? Trying to see Compton, the industry can hate me. Marlon, the mama, how many options?
Just made it a little bit more. Good morning. How we doing? All right, you guys look great. Actually, I'm lying. I can't see you because the lights are so blinding. No, but I want to imagine that you look great because I'm sure you do. But again, good morning. On behalf of the Board of Directors of AMAC Trade, also the Board of Directors of the Foundation Board led by the amazing Sunshine White, who's somewhere here. She and her board, they're doing an amazing job. And the AMAC PAC, which I believe is wrapping up its breakfast this morning. We welcome you to the 39th Annual AMAC Business Diversity Conference. So again, good morning. Before I get into some very brief remarks, I want to thank the great mayor, Mayor Freddie O'Connell, who's in the back, who will be speaking to you a little bit later, and his amazing leadership here at Nashville. Nashville is literally on fire. Well, not literally, but it is figuratively, it is on the move. I think the last note I heard about its growth was some 200 people per day moved to this city. I mean, I don't know if there's another city that can tout that. And the people are actually staying here, right? They're not just visiting. And so I just want to commend his leadership around Nashville. I also want to thank my good friend Doug Krulin, the CEO of Nashville International Airport. You know, his vision for the airport in general, but more specifically, how he combines that vision with the stuff that are important to us, that is represented with the fact that they're hosting this conference. And I think you would agree that they've done an amazing job so far with this conference. So let's give them a round of applause. An amazing job. They've been an amazing partner throughout this entire process. So we're in love with them, and we're looking forward to the rest of the conference. I also want to acknowledge, I'm not sure if he is in the room. Congressman Horsford, he's also the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus. He delivered a message this morning at the PAC board, and his vision for, let's give him a round of applause. There has never been a more important moment in our lives than today, and to have Chairman Horsford as the lead of the Congressional Black Caucus gives us great comfort and confidence that they will lead us in the right direction. So I just want to thank you very much for your leadership. Okay. So my friends, over the next few days, you're going to continue an amazing experience, an experience of inspiration, education, and uplift. That's what AMAC does. We do all of that at one time. Some of us spend a little more time struggling to recover from that than others, as I am now. You can tell I have my Denzel Washington voice right now. But we do get through it, and that's what makes AMAC so special. In this industry, we enjoy, those of you that are in this industry, we enjoy access to many conferences. There are several conferences. We have more conferences than anybody, any other industry I can imagine. And again, there are many. However, for all you first-timers, it won't take you long to realize what the AMAC family already knows, and that is they're not like us. They simply aren't like us. You know, programs and regulations that are important to us, we all know that DEI is under attack. As Congressman Horsford said this morning, that is our modern-day civil rights movement, is to fight back on those challenges. AMAC fights so hard to protect and preserve, and our members so benefit under those programs that are under attack. These efforts are more emboldened than several decades. As a matter of fact, as you walk the streets of Nashville, the amazing Nashville, as beautiful as this city is, as you walk the streets, you may witness hecklers, agitators aiming to escalate those attacks on us. As you travel the conference with poise, dignity, discipline, just remember, they're not like us. Okay. Later in the conference, on Tuesday, we will celebrate some of the best talent we have in this industry. And we have a very deep pool of talent in the AMAC family. If by chance, Lance Little wins another award and wears his same favorite jacket as last year, remember, he's not like us. All jokes aside, thank you for the many sponsors that provide us the financial support to enable this conference and the many services that exist post this conference. We really appreciate you. I want to acknowledge the events planning committee led by the amazing Karen Ellis. She's here somewhere. You can give her a round of applause. She and the committee members are generous with their time, their experience, and their resource. And all of that is necessary to pull off this amazing conference. Lastly, I want to acknowledge the national office. You know, we have an office that carries an enormous amount of work to provide you the services that you need. I often say that they truly punch above their weight class. And so we just want to thank them for the resilience, the drive that they've put into this conference to make it a success for you. And the leader of that group is the one and only Ebony Winbush. Ebony, the CEO and president of AMAC. Ebony continues to lead with a disciplined and focused approach to the challenges and opportunities before AMAC. So with that, I bring to you, and I hope I get a resounding applause, for Ebony Winbush, president and CEO of AMAC.
Best of clone on me. Everywhere I go, there'll be. Best of clone on me.
Good morning, AMAC family. Okay, we can do a little better than that, right? Good morning, AMAC family.
That's a tough
one. I know you guys were out seeing Cedric last night and doing a lot of line dances and Too Short was playing. But hopefully you got some rest, and it's great to see you this morning. I too have to start with thanking Mayor O'Connell. The city of Nashville, our airport host, Nashville International Airport, their planning committee and volunteers, they've been here every day, every morning, at the end of the day, and they deserve a round of applause. So thank you, Doug, Stacy, DeVita, Franklin. You guys have been great partners, great collaborators, making sure that this conference is a resounding success. Ricky thanked my team, but I also have to thank them. He said we punch above our weight. I sometimes say we're small but mighty. So thank you to the National Office team. Thank you to Karen and the event planning team. Our event planners, Events Essential, they are all critical to the success and the execution of this conference. But of course, yes, thank you. Nothing could happen, though, without our sponsors, right? This year, we have over 100 sponsors between our trade and foundation organization. And I need to thank them, but I have to give a special thanks to a few. Some of our platinum sponsors, including Baltimore-Washington International Thurgood Marshall Airport, our diamond sponsors, HMS Host Bahia Volta, Hudson Bahia Volta, Paradis Lagadère, SSP America, and United. These companies are not just leading the way this year, they've been leading the way every single year, ensuring that they support AMAC, contribute to the conference, and to contribute to the success of the conference in many ways. So thank you very much to those partners, and thank you to all of our sponsors. Please, let's give them a round of applause. So, you know, when I came, they talked about AMAC being an annual conference, and I think with our chapters, and they've been activated, and the events that they're having, the events that the national office has, we know that we're much more than a conference. And so our corporate partners participate, and they support us throughout the entire year. And so thank you to those corporate partners. Again, you are a part of the success of all that we do through your generous contributions. So we are nearly 1,500 strong. We had over 100 and some odd people register yesterday. We are confident that we're going to have some more register today, but we know that it's going to be time well spent. You know, this year, the theme of the conference, we haven't talked about it a lot, but I do want to spend a few moments on it. It's talking about soaring to new horizons, which embodies continued progress, collaboration with diverse perspectives to reach new heights. Nobody's really mentioned it, but this year, we've also celebrated the 60th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. That deserves a big round of applause. That act bans discrimination of race, color, religion, sex, national orientation, sexual orientation. It also bans discrimination in programs and activities receiving federal funding, some of the programs that you participate in. But this year, nearly 60 years later, while we've made progress, you know that we're facing well-coordinated, well-funded political and legal attacks on diversity, equity, and inclusion. So while we're making progress and our theme is about soaring, we still got a ways to go. The stakes are very high. You know, when that act passed, Lyndon Johnson talked about, we have come now to a time of testing. He said, we must not fail. Well, today, those words ring true. We must not fail. We each have a part. We have to continue to defend our progress. We each have a role, and AMAC is leading the way. Our strategic plan this year that we unveiled, the foundation of that is advocacy. Our Government Affairs Committee is rolling out a program, has rolled out a program, a strategy that involves our national and our local chapters to defend our programs. We met up on Washington, on Capitol Hill in March, and we heard from Kwaize Mfume from Maryland. Was anybody in the room that day? Did anybody come to our March Capitol Hill day? His message was powerful. He told us, he said, you know, listen, we might have to advocate and push and advocate and cajole, but then refuse to take no for an answer. And that's what I'm asking each of you to do, to defend our program. We're gonna spend 3 days here. We've got an exceptional program planned for you. We've got everything that you could want. Entertainment, education, best practices, new knowledge on federal rules. Our federal partners are here. They're here to listen to you. You should talk to them about your challenges and the opportunities, what's working, what's not working. They're excited to hear from you. We at AMAC are excited to be a conduit for this opportunity. So I'm asking you to buckle up. Take advantage of every moment that is here today. Listen, learn, share, open doors for each other, and then go back and do the work. Advocate for our programs in your local communities, through our chapters, through your relationships, through your access. AMAC will be doing that for you each and every day. Thank you very much. Welcome to Nashville. And now I have the distinct honor of bringing out our host airport sponsor, President and CEO, Doug Krulin. Doug?
Thank you.
I know I need my sunglasses again, so thank you all very much. We couldn't be more excited to welcome you to Nashville. We couldn't be more excited to be the host of the 39th Annual AMAC Business Diversity Conference. So we really do hope that you're going to have a great time here. It's hard to believe that it's been about 365 days since we last were visiting San Antonio and getting ready for this opportunity. San Antonio, you did a great job, and New Orleans is going to do a real good job as well. By applause, I saw dance moves and singers that I didn't recognize last night, but by applause, how many of you enjoyed After Seven and Cedric the Entertainer last night? pretty remarkable evening, and it wouldn't be possible without the outstanding staff that we have. Our Vice President, Stacy Nickens, down here for communications and marketing. Our Vice President of Procurement, Ms. Davita Taylor, is down here. They've been running this and a team of about 60 airport staff members preparing for this. But besides the internal work of the staff members that have been preparing for this, we have two outstanding commissioners that are here today, Commissioner Stevenson, Joyson Stevenson, and Commissioner Glenda Glover. So thank you all very much. Those ladies are my bosses, and they're also the ones that support the initiatives to convert our concessions program, our constructions program, into the betterment of Nashville and helpfully make us reflect our community. Those two ladies that serve on the Board of Commissioners, as well as the other commissioners, stand on the shoulders of giants. We had a former commissioner and board member, John Greer, years ago, that was instrumental in the establishment of AMAC that we know today, and I think he would be proud to know that individuals like Commissioner Samuels, Commissioner Debbie Wright, Commissioner Stevenson, and Glover are building on that tradition that we started so many, many years ago. I couldn't thank them enough for their leadership, couldn't thank our staff enough for their leadership, but we both, the commission and the staff of the airport, are here because we represent a great city. We like to think of ourselves as the first door to the city when you're arriving and the last door that you're going to see when you're going back home. And we have great leaders in the city. And ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to introduce the 10th mayor of the Metropolitan Government of Nashville and Davidson County. He's a great partner for the airport, he's a great recruiter for the airport, and he's a great leader for our city. Please welcome Mayor Freddie O'Connell.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you, Doug, Ebony, Ricky. Of course, any conference with great walk-on music is one I want to be at. And I, you know, this is the strangest part of being mayor of Music City is getting to be on the ones and twos and spin a little bit of usher at our New Year's Eve celebration. So it is not every city in America that you get to have those kinds of opportunities, but that's a great opportunity to say to our guests from out of town, including our amazing partners from USDOT, it's my honor to welcome you to Music City, USA. And of course, to my fellow, yeah, you can applaud for that. I know we've got some Nashvillians in the room, and thank you for your partnership to make this amazing place we call home even better. And I can't say thank you enough to the Airport Minority Advisory Council for bringing the Airport Business Diversity Conference to Nashville. This is such an extraordinary opportunity for the city, and I think you all are here at exactly the right time. This is a place where the name Music City comes not from country and the experience you may have on Broadway, but from an HBCU, and our oldest academic institution, in fact, Fisk University and the Fisk Jubilee Singers. And that legacy is on the rise, not just Fisk, but now the Tennessee State University. Both enjoy Grammy award-winning performances and albums. And so music is our brand, but you can see it's the diversity that helped build it. It's a critical strength that helps make Nashville a more interesting place, but has actually also fueled a lot of our growth. We have become a global city, and you can see the global interest in Nashville, as well as the national interest, just from the successes of the airport. The airport has been a tremendous partner, but also leading in innovation and in our success. Back in September, on the same day I was sworn into office, the Nashville International Airport unveiled its new international arrivals facility with six new gates to accommodate surging international travel to and from Middle Tennessee. And if you want a sense of, I guess, how good Doug is in terms of knowing where y'all's themes are, after they completed a $1.5 billion investment in B&A Vision, their next iteration of their growth, expansion, and innovation is called, of course, New Horizon. So Doug knows where the future is going, and it's, again, it's why I think it's so important that this conference is here right now, that their next phase is just getting started. But if you want a sense of Nashville's resiliency as a city that, like every other city, endured the challenges of the pandemic, we've also been through some unusual challenges where we had a historic flood back in 2010, just absolutely devastating to the physical area, bombing in our downtown core a few years ago. And so a lot of our success is also built around resiliency, and that's another place where our diversity shines. But coming out of the pandemic, our downtown recovered faster than any other major metropolitan area in the United States. There are a lot of contributing factors, but one of them is the overall diversity of our economy and the people who make it go. And that is why, as mayor, I'm proud to be leading a local government that continues to advance policies anchored in equity, inclusion, and belonging. Because those policies leverage our strengths and our people, and they help supercharge our economy. And if you've gotten any chance to spend time in the city, you'll see a major construction site across the Cumberland River from where we are right now. The Titans are building a new football stadium over there. And they set a 25% MWBE target for development on that facility. And more than that, it's a big deal. But they've also seen Doug and the airport team's successes with vending. And you better believe there are going to be some local vendors in the new stadium they're creating that is going to showcase local support. Now, the benefit of watching that new stadium come out of the ground is we get to reclaim as a city 100 plus acres of public land. And not to be outdone, as they develop a new stadium and we develop new neighborhoods, we have a target of 30% MWBE participation in development activities on the East Bank. And that entire momentum for what you're seeing there in the vendor mix and the construction and development mix in everybody who's helping build the next chapter of Nashville's future, it builds on the success of something remarkable that I got to play a small role in when I was still on the Metro Council. We created something called the Equal Business Opportunity Program, which has invested across more than 250 contracts nearly $1 billion in women and minority-owned businesses in just 5 years. It's an incredible track record. And those are people doing business with Metro, and we tried to clear the obstacles. And I know in the audience, get a chance to meet her if you haven't already. My colleague on the Metro Council, who was one of the leaders helping get that done, is Sharon Hurt. So go look up Councilmember Hurt and say hi if you get a chance today, because she helped us find the way as a city. So all of that is to let you know that our Nashville is seeking to be a welcoming and friendly community. I hope that as you experience this incredible conference, that's what you find. It's our goal, and it's something that I'm personally committed to, and I'm so honored to have you all here and excited to wish you a great conference. Thanks so much for having me.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Vice Chair, AMAC PAC Board of Directors, and Managing Partner of Cruise Hospitality, Mr. Nicholas Cruz.
Good morning. I have the pleasure and honor of introducing Congressman Stephen Horsford. First elected into Congress in 2018, winning an open seat in the 4th District of Nevada, and was reelected in 2020 and 22. Horsford is the first African American to represent Nevada in Congress and has achieved leadership roles, including the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus and the co-chair of the Congressional Labor Caucus. Prior to Congress, Representative Horsford built a successful career in workforce development. For more than a decade, Horsford led the state's largest career training program at the Nevada Culinary Training Academy. In 2023, Representative Horsford was elected chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, the first frontline member to ever serve in this role. Under his leadership, the CBC has grown to an impressive 60 members representing 120 million Americans, the largest in its history. This expansion has bolstered the CBC's efforts to advance transformative policies and for Chairman Horsford to instill a day one agenda, including a Black Wealth and Economic Opportunity Plan to address housing, entrepreneurship, and fair and equitable taxation to reduce the racial wealth gap. His strategic efforts underscore Horsford's commitment to advancing equitable legislation and fortifying sustainable economic empowerment, not just for Black communities, but also in coalition with Latino, Asian, and other historically underrepresented people. Now, over the past 4 years, I've been fortunate to advocate on behalf of this industry and had the opportunity to meet with a lot of congressional members. And it was last year, this time, in San Antonio, I had my first call with Chairman Horsford. And during that call, I felt a deeper level of understanding of the industry's challenges and the opportunities, a connection on a personal level, and a shared vision and alignment of AMAC's mission and his day one agenda for the CBC. So now, please join me in welcoming Congressman Stephen Horsford.
Well, good morning. It's great to be with all of you. Thank you to Nick for that overly generous introduction. And it's great to be with AMAC and the airport directors in your 2020 Vision Forum. I am Congressman Stephen Horsford. I'm proud to represent Nevada's 4th Congressional District. And thanks to your industry, we host millions of visitors in Las Vegas every single year who travel through your airports to get to the Harry Reid International Airport. Any Vegas people in the house? All right. But we are so proud to work alongside all of you in promoting tourism and hospitality, which is staffed by some of the most hardworking and dedicated people throughout this country. So I always give a shout out to the people who make our industry strong. I currently serve as chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, as Nick indicated, and I'm proud to head the largest caucus in our history with 60 members from throughout the country in every region of the country. As a caucus, we have worked on creating an agenda for all Americans, one that creates the opportunities of economic prosperity and intergenerational wealth building. We are harnessing the tools of economic prosperity to make sure that we create those opportunities not only for ourselves, but for our families and in the communities that we operate. Generational wealth has been unattainable for far too many populations because of the roadblocks that have stood in their way. And we have worked to remove those roadblocks. Airport concessionaires are one of those areas that has been unfortunately out of reach for far too many entrepreneurs in the past. But you all are changing that, and the Congressional Black Caucus wants to work with you as partners. The Disadvantaged Business Enterprise and the ACDBE programs are congressionally mandated programs that were created over 40 years ago. Congress created them to address the effects of past discrimination against small businesses that were owned and controlled by minorities, women, and other socially and economically disadvantaged individuals. And they continue today to help prevent and address ongoing discrimination. The Department of Transportation's DBE program is designed to remedy these efforts of past discrimination in federally assisted highway, transit, airport, and highway safety financial assistance transportation contracts. And I want to commend the Undersecretary Christopher Coase, as well as Irene Marion, the Director of the Department of Civil Rights, for their phenomenal work in this regard. To be clear, we're just asking for fairness and opportunity to compete like everybody else. As we journey on a path of helping more and more Americans create their own success and build their own wealth, we must address and remove the barriers that they have had to overcome. And at a time when there are attacks on the very tools of opportunity, whether it be the AC-DBE program or the Minority Business Development Administration or diversity, equity, and inclusion specifically in the private sector, when they attack DE&I, they are attacking you and I. But to be clear, we are in a multiracial society. We're not going back. We're going to continue to move forward. And when we make sure that businesses have access to these programs, we are lifting up all of our communities, all of our people, and all Americans. Among its many updates, the Department of Transportation's final rule will reduce burdens on firms and recipients, grow firm capacity and owner wealth, and improve program integrity, visibility, and data that's collected by the department. These changes will directly impact eligible firms and the contractors that hire them. And I'm proud that the Congressional Black Caucus, working with other members in partnership with the Biden-Harris administration, have made these commitments to advance equity across all of government. The U.S. Department of Transportation's Equity Action Plan made a public commitment to modernize DBE and AC-DBE programs through the rulemaking process. And because of all of your engagement and your responses, this program is stronger than ever. The rule provides new opportunities for these businesses and enterprises to be a part of the bipartisan infrastructure law that includes highways, transit, airport, and highway safety projects that are being delivered nationwide. This is more than $1 trillion of economic opportunity that we have to be a part of. Working with your airports, we look forward to partnering with all of you to open opportunities to businesses and to entrepreneurs in your communities and to make sure that they can all be a part of the great success that your airports are seeing. So let me close by just saying that the Congressional Black Caucus, in coalition with the Hispanic Caucus and the Asian American Pacific Islander Caucus, we're known as the Tri-Caucus. We are prioritizing creating economic opportunity, prosperity, and building intergenerational wealth, and we will do that in partnership with all of you. So let's keep building wealth for all of America. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman Horsford. I have the distinct honor to give a new award, a visionary award. AMAC has established the Visionary Award to honor the U.S. Department of Transportation for its leadership in advancing transportation equity and wealth creation. So this Visionary Award is given to an organization or an individual that holds equitable and future forward vision for economic inclusion and economic impact. The award also recognizes the distinct contributions of the USDOT's Office of Civil Rights. Director Marion, where are you? There you go. She deserves a really, really big round of applause. Please, please stand up, Director Marion. I mean, she is pushing her team. She is coordinating with operating agencies. She is doing the work to make the program better. And so we honor you for that, and we thank you. And so I'm going to bring out Undersecretary Christopher Coase to accept this honor on behalf of the Department of Transportation and to provide a few remarks. So Undersecretary Coase, please.
Wow, now I feel like I'm at the Grammys here now. Well, good morning, good morning. I won't be long, but I really just want to take this moment to say that on behalf of the Department of Transportation, Secretary Pete Buttigieg, it's really an honor to be with all of you today. First, let me just recognize the amazing leadership of MAMAC, Madam President Ebony Wimbush, our great board chair, Ricky Smith. Let's give them a round of applause for their leadership. I also just want to take this moment to also thank the planning committee, the host committee, including Mayor O'Connell, and our friends at the Nashville International Airport and the city of Nashville. I have to say, in less than 48 hours, you've really put on a show. It's really exciting, and it's an honor to accept this visionary award on behalf of my incredible colleagues at the Department of Transportation, who really, since day one, have been working to advance the president's vision to making sure that we have wealth-creating opportunities for every single American. Secretary Pete Buttigieg heard from a lot of stakeholders, particularly those in this room, and has activated a number of our DOT teams who've been working every day tirelessly to implement some of our key wealth creation initiatives. Some of those individuals are in this room today, and I want to honor them. You just heard Irene Marion, please stand as I call your name. Tyra Reedus, who's our director of our Office of Small and Disadvantaged Business Utilization. Angela Berry Robertson, our senior advisor and co-lead of our DOT Wealth Creation Initiatives. Mark Bettino, Gene Roth, and many of our DOT career staff, who for many years have been moving the modernization of our DBE program and ACDB programs. For all of my colleagues, please rise and accept this award and this recognition. See you guys in the back. Thank you. You have your seat. Look, the work that we're doing at the Department of Transportation is crucial, not only to build a safer and world-class infrastructure system, but it's more important to make sure that these investments are not only creating good paying jobs, but actually creating a legacy of wealth creation. These investments are something I saw firsthand as someone who lived in rural Southwest Georgia, where I saw Ann Atlanta, Hartsfield Jackson, being and still is the shining beacon of what can happen when we unleash the full potential of our communities. And in this case, the largest creation of the largest black middle class in a region. We just visited Hartsfield Jackson earlier this year. And let me tell you, it was beautiful to see and meet multi-generational DBE and ACDBE business owners who not only had early successes, but are now passing these businesses down to the next generation. But look, I know all of you know this, but over time, our DBE and our ACDBE programs got a little out of date. And I can tell you, a lot of years, a lot of talk was going on. But you all know, and as the young people will say, this past spring, we did a thing. Or in proper government etiquette, we announced the most significant rule change to the DBE and ACDBE in the history of the program. Look, in response to so many ideas and the feedback from AMAC and so many stakeholders, the DBE and the ACDBE program now includes some of the most critical changes, which according to some folks in this room that I talked to at the bar, are saying these changes are beyond game-changing. There are two I'll just mention. The personal net worth adjustment. For folks who haven't been paying attention, we adjusted the personal net worth cap for inflation for small businesses from $1.3 million to over $2 million. Yeah. In addition to this increase, we listened and we also heard you. So in the final rule, we also excluded your retirement assets from the calculation of your personal net worth. And I think we can all agree, this significant increase and the exclusion means that firms that would have been on the verge of outgrowing their DBE and ACDBE certification would not have had the chance, but now has the opportunity to take advantage of the $660 billion of infrastructure dollars that are going to communities across the country. We did that. I also heard that people were really excited that we also made a change to our interstate certification. For years, we heard from DBEs how hard it was to get a phone call back or get that letter back, and how sometimes it could take months, 100 days, even more, to get your certification. But now, because of this new final rule, you don't have to wait 100 days, you don't have to wait 30 days, but now within 10 days, you're able to get certified with states nearby. We did that. Look, that's just some of the things we did and changed in the DBE and ACDBE rule. We're in full implementation mode now. Over the last several months, our team has been hosting dozens of trainings, both virtually and in person. And let me tell you right now, we got a training session happening this week. So repeat after me, get trained, spread the word. Get trained, spread the word. Now, in addition to these efforts, for the last 3.5 years, the Biden-Harris administration has worked tirelessly to advance racial justice and creating, again, wealth-building opportunities for every single American. Now, some of you might be from the state of Tennessee. Shout out if you are. Okay, I got a few folks. Even in Tennessee, we have given over $6.8 billion to over hundreds of projects, including $3.5 billion to help improve your roads and your bridges, $450 million to support your public transit, $200 million for your airports, $15 million for your ports and waterways. And let me just put a final point on that. $30 billion went to help upgrade Memphis International, Nashville International, Chattanooga Metropolitan Airport, as well as many of the rural and small and important airports. We did a thing. So with that, for those who don't live in Tennessee, you should know that these investments are happening every part of this country. We have now investing in over 60,000 projects in a pipeline that will take over a decade to deliver. In addition to these resources, in addition to these changes, we recognize that we got to give capacity. And that's why we have facilitated and built out our small business capacity building, including our technical assistance programs and resources facilitated by the great Office of Small and Disadvantaged Business Utilization. We also heard that you want to connect to capital. That's why we launched a new access to capital platform and a new focus on pathways to entrepreneurship for new markets. And guess what? We're hosting an event this September. Make sure you sign up and spread the word. So in addition to that, we recognize that we can't sit in Washington. And AMAC, we're calling on you to join us as we go to communities across the country. Already, we've been in Houston and Cleveland as part of this DOT wealth creation tour. We will be hosting an event here in Nashville tonight, this afternoon. Please sign up and attend. But more importantly, to all my Pennsylvania friends in the room, I'll be seeing you in September. Look, these efforts have been a priority of this administration since day one. It remains a priority, and I know with the partnership with AMAC and so many of you in the room, this will be the goal for years to come. As the old folks would say, we have come a long way, but there's still so much more work to do. There's still so much promise, so much opportunity, so much work to be done. While I can say on the Department of Transportation, we really appreciate this award. We really appreciate and celebrate AMAC's not only leadership and partnership, but I have to be honest with you. We are more looking forward to working with you to ensure that in 40 years of the DBE and the ACDB program, we were able to grow to 50,000 certified DBEs and 3,500 ACDBEs. Then if you sign up, get your training, spread the word, there's no reason why we can't triple that in the next decade. Join us in that cause. We are there with you every step of the way. We look forward to seeing you not only today at today's session, but again, we appreciate this recognition. Now let's get to work.